This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Welcome to Dreamland. As always, I'm excited. I'm excited every week, or I wouldn't be doing this. I'm excited every week because it's really a fun thing to be doing. The guest and I were just talking just before the show about the fact that both of us have been involved with UFOs for a long time. And the reason being, this is probably the most extraordinary and interesting subject in the world. And one of the most interesting people involved in that subject is none other than Robert Powell, who's got a new book out about UFOs, and we're going to be talking about that. But Robert is he's been involved in UFO research since, for 16 years, it says here. And since I'm a fabulous mathematician, I'm guessing that was just about 16 years ago, whenever that was. Robert, welcome to Dreamland. I'm glad to have you on the show.
Hi, Whitley. It's good to be on your show again. And it's actually been 17 years now, because it was 16 years when I wrote the book. And you know, there's a little time delay before it's published.
Right.
So now I'm at 17 years in the subject.
Another UFO book. What makes it different?
So the difference to me in this book is I explain why I believe the UFO phenomenon is real. And so what I do in the book is I give reasons why, number one, it's a physical reality. It's not a figment of people's imagination. And number two, whatever it is far in advance of us, and it demonstrates intelligence and technological capability. And I go into the book and explain how I draw those conclusions. And I make it as scientific as possible. So for those who like numbers, they can try to come to the same conclusion that I come to. Or not.
Or not, yeah. Well, you know, the thing about the phenomenon is that you emphasize its physicality. And that immediately brings up a question of, it's kind of on a shadow line between the physical and the non-physical. I mean, like when we had people up at our cabin, routinely, people would see their dead friends and relatives along with the physical beings in the phenomenon. It was, you know, you could often have a situation where in one room there were people experiencing physical contact with a physical being, and in another room, a dead relative was there. So what in the world is going on there? Do you have any idea? Because I'm torn between the idea that the dead really exist in this context, and that there's something that these beings are so good at doing stuff to your mind. I mean, they can bake your head real fast.
Yeah.
So just talk to that a little bit.
So, you know, there are, my personal view is that there is more than just one UFO phenomenon per se. In other words, I don't believe this is of just one origin. And I don't know the origin, but I believe there's more than one origin. And when you said, Whitley, you know, how it kind of does things with your head, there's a lot of that in different aspects. I'll give you one example. I interviewed a husband and wife. The husband's a forest ranger, and the wife was a math teacher. And every morning they would get up at about 5 a.m. and she would have fixed him coffee, and then they, you know, she gives him a kiss goodbye and off they go. And, you know, leaves every morning, same time. And both of them enjoy looking at the stars. One morning, the same routine's going on. And, you know, the stars are out because this is around 4 to 5 in the morning. He looks up at the stars and he's looking at the Orion constellation. And one of the stars in Orion is Rigel. And both the husband and wife are, you know, good amateur astronomers, and they know the names of those stars, know where they're at. They know the constellations. And as he's looking at Rigel, it suddenly brightens 2 to 3 times its normal brightness. And his wife sees it, and, you know, they're discussing how can that be? Because Rigel's not a variable star, you know, it's no indication it should be going supernova or anything. So what's going on? Well, they don't figure it out. She goes, she gets ready to do something else. She turns, and he's looking at it. And then all of a sudden, the star dims back to its normal brightness, and this little UFO, UAP, whatever you want to call it, starts to revolve around Rigel. And then it goes away. And to him, it was almost like it was saying, hey, look, I'm, you know, you can know I'm here because I'm revolving around this star, right? And it's doing things it should not do. So if you think about it, for that to happen, whatever this object was, if it moved in front of Rigel and brightened itself, right, to make it look like Rigel brightened, then that means it was doing this for this particular witness, right? Because they have to align with each other. And so someone 2 miles away would not see that happen. It only could happen to this individual and his wife who are looking at it. And so that's an example, one example of how it deals with your mind.
You know, it reminds me of a gentleman now, a dear friend now, sadly passed to the great beyond, called John Glideman. And John was a physicist and I believe also a psychologist, a very brilliant man. And when the communion experience hit, he and I worked together a lot on what else could it be? Anything but what it seemed to be. That was our basic approach. And we even considered the idea that the sound of the refrigerator in the house had triggered some kind of hallucinatory effect. We really went deep. However, what happened was that John proceeds. He is also an amateur astronomer with scopes and pretty seriously into it. And we're outside. And he says, wait a minute, look at that star. That star. I said, what star? He said, because I'm not an astronomer at all. And he says, there's a star underneath the moon that shouldn't be there. I said, how do you know? He said, because I know the sky and there's that an extra star. Whereupon, as if on command, it proceeds to go around the moon, return to its original place and disappear. And then we changed our approach entirely to the question of what had happened to me.
Right. Yeah.
It's such cool stuff. I mean, you know, why do you think it chose these people to do this with?
That's the $64,000 question. Why did it choose these particular people? Clearly, I've never been chosen. So, you know, I've never even seen a UFO.
Yeah, that's fascinating because, you know, why did you choose yourself to do this? I'm going to ask that question.
Well, because when I was a teenager, I read J. Allen Hynek's book, The UFO Experience. Yeah. And, you know, it's written in kind of a science type mode. And I enjoyed the book. And of course, life gets in the way, right? You go to college, you get married, you have a family. And I was able to retire early. And so I went back to remembering, you know, that book because I kept it all those years. And I said, I want to go back and look at this again. And at that point in time, I didn't have an opinion one way or another about UFOs. So I began studying the subject. And the more I studied it, the more it became apparent to me that there's a reality to this. And even though I've never seen a true UFO myself, this allowed me to, you know, to really get involved in the subject. And I've been in it ever since for the last 17 years. Now, One thing that I did want to mention, Whitley, you know, when we were talking about how this gets into your head, for example. So one thing I've contemplated on abductions, and let me say right from the beginning that I am not an expert in abductions. That's not my area. But when you're in the field for 17 years, you run across a lot of people who have had an abduction and talk to you about it.
Robert, we're going to take a brief break, and this is a good time to do it. And when we get back, folks, we're going to be talking about abductions. We'll be right back. With two contactees who had an 11-day close encounter experience and are now willing to speak about it, really, for the first time. To hear their whole interview and many others, subscribe to unknowncountry.com. Here's the excerpt. Did you see the man's face?
Yes. Actually, that one is very clear to me. It was kind of longish, and he didn't look completely human, but because he had very, very thin hair, almost non-existent, but he was young. I believe that it was kind of blonde, and he was very tall, like at least six feet, and he was so thin that he looked kind of strange.
And what happened then?
Well, he wanted me to go with him, or to stay with him. He wanted me to stay with him on the ship. And I'd been married for 6 months, and I wasn't about to go running off to stay on the ship.
Now, surely you want more. You must want more. And there is more, not only this contactee interview, but many others, many of them just as extraordinary, on unknowncountry.com, plus everything else that we offer, my audio books, the meditations, the talks on the key, William Henry's wonderful revelation show and its entire run, and Strieber's brilliant and magical mysterious powers, and so much more. Hours and hours of listening pleasure. Learn from the meditations on the site. Really learn, because they're real and they're valuable. Subscribe to unknowncountry.com right now. Go to unknowncountry.com. Click on the subscribe tab. We are running very low on new subscribers now, and that should not be. It should not be happening. So you do it. You go there and you do it today.
I'm Dreamland's new monthly guest host. You can catch me here on the last Friday of every month. If you're interested in checking out my other work, you can find that on my podcast, The UFO Rabbit Hole. On that show, I share my own personal research with deep dives into everything from historical cases to philosophical frameworks, as well as in-depth interviews with top thinkers in the field, like Jeffrey Kripal, Diana Walsh-Pasulka, Bernardo Kastrup, James Madden, and of course, Dreamland's own Whitley Strieber. You can find the UFO Rabbit Hole on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever else you listen to podcasts. Just search for the UFO Rabbit Hole. And if you like what you hear and you want to go even further down the rabbit hole with me, I'd like to invite you to join my Patreon community. Patrons get perks like early access to new content and ad-free episodes. I host twice monthly patron-only Zoom calls where you can ask me questions, share your own thoughts, and connect with others. We also have a lively and active private Discord server where members host book clubs, happy hours, and just share their thoughts on all things anomalous without all the drama that's all too common on social media. It's a warm, open-minded, and vibrant community, and we'd love to have you join us. Memberships start at just $5 a month. You can sign up at patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole. That's patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole.
We're talking to Robert Powell. His new book, UFOs, The Scientist Explains What We Know and Don't Know About UFOs. I got the title right?
Yes.
Okay, good. All right. Before we left the air, we were getting ready to talk about abductions. And this is not your field of your wheelhouse, but you've still got some ideas because you've probably met a lot of people like me who have had abduction experiences.
Right. And I've had people, you know, that tell me an abduct their experience and story. And some people, you know, you're not sure you believe them. But then there's other people right. that tell you the story. And it's like, wow, I can't believe, I mean, this certainly sounds, he sounds very honest and straightforward. He's not trying to get attention, or she, whichever it happens to be. And so one thought I've had is, what if the abduction happens only in the witness's mind? And by that, I don't mean the witness has a psychological episode. I mean another entity, wherever that entity is. I mean, it could be, for all I know, it could be 50,000 light years away. But it puts the exact experience into the person's mind. And as far as that person's concerned, it happened. And there's no way, if it happened to me, there's no way I could discern between that and reality, because reality is what we experience in our minds. So that's one possibility I've thought about, Whitley, is, you know, could that be the case? Could it be manipulation of our mind?
Well, I think that to an extent must be the case, because in my situation, I mean, I've been doing this and had multiple encounters with the visitors over now a period of 30 years. And they range in very complicated ways from things I would say were definitely physical experiences because there were physical consequences to things that are much more like what you're describing and suggesting. For example, the first experience resulted was I was injured badly, was raped. And I struggled with the pain from that and was under periodic medical treatment for it for 20 years because of the scar tissue. And that was real. Something happened. But here's the thing, and I can get back to John Glyman. We discussed this endlessly. Yes, I was raped. No question. But was I raped by what I saw? Or was there something else going on? Now, to expand on that a little bit, a year after the experience and after Communion had been published, probably a little more than a year, therefore, a friend came over. He was a state trooper, a retired state trooper, and proceeded to tell me that he had seen it happen to me. He had been coming home that night at 2 o'clock in the morning with his wife from a party and seen what he thought was a crashed blimp in a field near our houses. And he got out of his car to try to see if he could help. And when he walked toward it, lights came on all over it, started making a growling noise and came toward him very menacingly. And of course, his wife back in the car freaked out completely. And it's understandably so at 2 o'clock in the morning with that happening. And he did too, and he jumped in the car and they drove away. And he said to me, Whitley, I think you were the one, and I could hear someone screaming in there. I think it was you. And I just want to apologize that I didn't try to help you. I said to him, Wayne, you're very lucky that you didn't go down there, because God only knows what would have happened to you. But here's the thing. This all adds up to a physical experience, almost undeniably. And, you know, I can massage it all I want to, but the bottom line is physical injuries, and a friend saw it happen. So where do we take that?
I don't know. I mean, could it be that same scene was put into his head, right, by an outside force?
The answer is yes. And that's what makes it so endlessly fascinating. You know, David Grusch, in his testimony, alluded to the fact that we have bodies. We possess bodies, physical bodies of visitors. And, I don't think I'm talking out of court. I don't have a security clearance. I've heard the same thing, that we do possess three bodies, and they are at Fort Detrick in Maryland. And therefore, the question becomes, what in the world could that be about? Where could they be from? Because you look at everything we understand about this universe, and if they're from the same physical universe we're in, how in the name of God did they get here?
Well, yeah, they for them to have gotten here, they, in assuming they're from another planet around a different star, they either traveled at near light speed or they traveled faster than light in order to get here. It has to be one of those two possibilities.
Yeah, near light speed has a lot of problems. Like, the exponential increase in mass is tremendous. In other words, folks, the faster you go, the heavier you get. And it gets to a point when it would be noticeable in the universe if something reached like 99% of the speed of light. It doesn't happen that physical objects go that fast. So is there a way to go beyond that? Well, here's the problem with, a wormhole. Well, yeah, but here you think of the universe as a big, thick piece of steel, very thick. To make a wormhole, you have to bend the entire thing. And what does that tell you? It tells you, excuse me for getting off camera, I apologize. It tells you that the amount of energy necessary to create a wormhole must be greater than the entire energy of the universe. So that seems to be an unlikely way of getting around also. Unless there's a way of getting around that we don't know, and that's possible, I suppose, they can't have come here. And I just find that, I find this conundrum fascinating, because I won't say you're wrong that it's not all in the head, and I won't say that the injuries were caused in some other way. But then I ask the question, why would they be doing this? Because they get nowhere. This thing is just knocking along the same way it has been for years. If you go back to the NICAP days, we were just about ready to do this. Roscoe Hill Encoder was sitting in front of Congress saying it's time for this to all come out, years and years ago. And now we're doing the same thing, and the DOD is resisting in exactly the same way it did before. The Arrow report is a retread of Project Blue Book. I think it's almost a cut and paste job. So where are we with this? Robert, I mean, we're in some kind of a maze of mirrors that we can't get out of.
Well, we've spent 80 years with the military trying to resolve this, right? And that's one of the things I point out in my book. I think it's time to give up on the military trying to come up with a solution to UFOs and turn instead to academia. Because the big difference between those two groups, because the military does have access to, university professors and very intelligent people, but everything is closed. It's a closed system that you don't let others into it. Well, with academia, it's an open system, and that's the entire concept, to share your data. Like with Aero, we've never seen the data that makes up those reports that they show, the charts that they show. That data you don't get to see. You only get to see the results. And that's why we need to change. And with academia, you could get to see the data. And I think that's critical to making progress.
Well, the academic approach is fundamentally different from the scientific approach. You know, my friend Jeff Kripal would love what you're saying, because he would agree with you entirely. And I think there's a lot of substance in this idea, because what would be different if academia was leading the charge here?
So if academia is leading the charge, then you initially you have to provide them funding, right, to make it happen. So assuming you've done that and they're leading the charge, you bring in the younger generations and you take data and conclusions that have been driven, and then other people look at those and then they say, well, maybe that's right, but not this part of it. And they try to review the work you've done and duplicate that work. So I think it's important that all the cards are out on the table, because as long as let me back up. Let's say if you assume we're dealing with something much more intelligent than ourselves, it's going to be very difficult to make headway. And then to make headway, you're not even providing all the information to the sharpest people, you know, on the planet that can work on this, then you might as well not even try, which is where we're at today. So I think we should at least try and provide all the information and see if we can come up with, you know, some kind of answers to what we are dealing with.
Because we're not there, not even close to answers. And we've been struggling with this for years and years, and yet you and I still have to sit here and talk about whether or not it's even real in the physical sense. And that's a serious issue. Even to a guy who's been beat up by it plenty of times, not just the one time, but I've had him in my life many times. And they look physical quite often, not always, but quite often. They've even, you know, they fool with my body every once in a while. And I can't disagree with you, though. I don't think that I have any final, I guess the one thing I have is this implant. This is a real thing, and you can take a CT scan of it, people. In fact, I'll just make a note here to drop my CT scan. I'm making a note to drop my CT scan on the image here, and so people can see it again. It is real, and it's a physical object, but I didn't see any aliens put it in. It was put in by two people. I could ID them immediately. I'll never forget what they looked like. Two people, a man and a woman. And there were other people around the house. I could hear them talking. Backyard. This thing is extraordinary. It is an incredible piece of technology. A piece of it has been cut off and was examined at Southwest Research and found to have be a metal base with cilia on it, motile cilia. And when the doctor tried to remove it, the reason he didn't remove the whole thing is it went from there down into the earlobe on its own. And he pulled out, of course, because he put it, I'd have to take off your whole ear. The video, by the way, is on my website somewhere, folks. So I think it's probably in the subscriber area, which reminds me that, you know, you have a lot of reasons for subscribing to Unknown Country. You probably won't, but I think you should. Okay. So, but let's go on. What do you think we should do here? Should we try to, fix this in some kind of physical reality and say, yes, we know it's real? Because I think the other side of the coin is I think those bodies are at Fort Detrick. I don't know where they came from or what they are, but I think they are there. And I think that there were bodies found in Varginha in Brazil as well. And those bodies are somewhere. I don't know where. And these are physical entities. So my bottom line is, in the end, I'm going for the physical as a reality. You're not in that space, I don't think. Or are you? Where are you with that?
You mean, yes. Okay. So as to whether or not there are physical bodies, I don't know. My view, for example, of what David Grush has said is he's basically had two types of evidence. One is very authoritative people, he says, who have told him that there are, you know, physical bodies, that there's attempts to do a reverse technology. And then he said there are documents that he has seen. So of those two types of evidence, I think the most important are the documents that he claims to have seen. And so to me, it's just black and white. Either it's true or it's not true. And I think it's up to Congress to investigate his claims. And of course, I'm concerned whether Congress will truly investigate his claims, because until they do, it's just one of those he said, she said type situations. So I think it's important for Congress to, you know, find out what are the documents that Grush saw, and then go and find those documents and see what they say.
Yeah, I think that that's critical, but of course we can't do that. And Congress lacks will. We had when the Schumer Amendment was gutted by the Congress, by the House, it was gutted because the head of the House Intelligence Committee had got contributions, a lot of contributions from places like Lockheed Martin. And he intentionally gutted it to help them. And I think that's probably because of the fact that there is a lot hidden behind the scenes. And if you study patent law, you find out very quickly that you can't patent something that isn't, that you haven't invented. In other words, if you find an unusual mineral that's never been discovered before, you can't patent it. It's not an invention. The problem is that they have apparently taken a lot of materials and processes that they have derived from things that they found, wreckage and so forth, and patented that, and made a great deal of money off of those patents, to the harm of companies that weren't in the know. And so you've got a massive fraud going on there, a huge amount of criminal activity, and an untenable situation. And then you add to that the fact that the defense industry, I mean, the Department of Defense can't balance its budget and keeps losing trillions of dollars and saying publicly that a lot of its inventory can't be found. That tells me that someone senior moment. Sick of getting old. I've got to get younger again. Somehow we both do. In any case, Richard Dolan says that there's a breakaway civilization. He might be right. And if you look at that, those missing dollars in that budget, you think to yourself, well, we're paying for the damn thing. And they're hiding it. And they're taking our money and putting it in a hole that we can't see the bottom of. It's incredible. Robert, why would taking this into academia help us?
Well, of course, I have a little bit different view. I mean, I agree with you that the Schumer Amendment was gutted. And what you said is correct. The guy who gutted it, their primary source of campaign funds comes out of the defense industry. And Lockheed Martin was one of those companies. But what I don't believe that they have been able to reverse engineer any type of craft. So let's just make the assumption they have a craft or multiple crafts. Having worked in the semiconductor industry and done reverse engineering on our own type products, I know that you have to have the base technology in order to reverse engineering things. So let me give you an example. Let's say you took a modern laptop and gave it to the scientists of the year 1992. That's only 32 years ago. So you give them the schematics, everything they need. They don't even have to reverse engineer it. You just say, here, on a silver platter, here's how you make a modern laptop. The problem is they couldn't make it. And the reason they couldn't make it is they don't have the infrastructure, the scientific infrastructure to make that laptop. It doesn't matter if you told them how, right? Because today, in order to make the chips that go into that laptop, you need these photographic, we call them stepper systems, that use ultraviolet light. Well, in 1992, those did not even exist. All that existed was optical wavelengths to do that. The same is true for the metal and the metal structures that you use to make your lines that carry the current in the computer chip. Those systems did not exist in the year 1992. So, and those are just two items. There are hundreds of technologies that are required in order to build that laptop. And those technologies didn't exist in 1992. And we're talking about humans here with only 34, 40 years going by. You can imagine trying to reverse engineer a technology where you don't even understand the basic science that their technologies are built upon. So I don't think that we could effectively reverse engineer any alien technology, assuming we had a craft.
You know, my uncle Mickey was at Wright Field when the debris and the bodies were brought in from Roswell in 1947. That was where he was stationed, and in the Air Materiel Command, actually. And he witnessed this. And his friend Arthur Exon, who was later commandant of Wright Pat, also did. And they both of them talked to me pretty extensively about their experiences. After I published Communion, my uncle went so far as to get me to come down to Air Force Village at Lackland in San Antonio and just sit with him for a couple hours and talk it all out. And interesting, I could never tell. He was very careful. My uncle, in his whole career, you never really found out anything about what he did. He was attached to the Atomic Energy Commission from Air Force Intelligence for most of his career, and that was kind of all we knew. But he said some fascinating things obliquely and carefully. He said, among other things, that they had found a thing that no one understood and that it was empty. That is to say, it was just, as I understood it, it had balsa wood framing, but the balsa wood couldn't be, nothing could be done to it any more than the very thin metal it was made of. It was just as strong. And these partitions in it made of some kind of paper that was equally impermeable. And in other words, it looked like some kind of a little toy. And yet it had contained these bodies that were there. And he didn't say this, but I've heard plenty of rumors that one of them was alive. I don't know. Nathan Twining, who was directly involved in this also, and of course wrote the Twining memorandum, his son said that the general had talked to one of them and it had said that they weren't interested in human beings. And I thought to myself, well, that makes sense. The first words we hear from them are their first, but not only, lie. So, you know, I like to live on this shadow line where all of this stays in question. I mean, I had my own uncle tell me these things, but I still would say that he also was describing something that a child could have made if the child had superhuman abilities to manipulate metal. So, you know, another man, Dr. Robert Sauerbacher, told me that they had found the metal. This is 1986. I talked to him. You can look him up on the internet. Robert Sauerbacher, Sarbacher, I believe. He was involved in analyzing the Roswell debris, and he was very open about it. He didn't have a security clearance, and he just put stuff up. I mean, he wrote letters and things. Sadly enough, the day after I talked to him, he fell off of a boat and died. At least that's what the UPS guy who tried to deliver something for me to him told me. In any case, when I was talking to him, he said that they had found that the molecules of the metal were in an organized grid pattern that gave the metal incredible tensile strength, and that we could not do that. We could not manipulate atoms, which is what you would have had to do to accomplish this. And but then fast forward to an abductee who years later was lying in a hammock, and one of these little beings came up under the hammock and said, "We rearrange atoms." Can you imagine that? To an abductee explaining the Roswell metal perfectly. And if you can rearrange atoms, you're now a magician. Science is beyond, it's beyond science, it's magic. And we are just at the edge of learning how to do that. We're not far from being able to rearrange atoms. So I would like to ask you another question. And I'm sorry to be so long-winded, but I kind of have to lead these things, make this into a story. What about the future? Could the future be looking back at us through the lens of these strange eyes? And could it be that the grandfather paradox isn't triggered if they look at us through the eyes of something that doesn't exist? In other words, behind those alien faces are us from the future.
Well, that's an interesting thought, right? That perhaps they're us from the future. I mean, the main argument against it is what you mentioned, the grandfather clause, right? Can you go back in time? You do something that changes the future, and then suddenly you don't exist anymore.
Right, exactly.
So I'm not sure that always is difficult to comprehend.
That's right. You go back into the dinosaur era, step on a flower, and we're all still Neanderthals.
Yeah, exactly. It's the butterfly effect, right?
Right.
A very small change gets magnified rapidly.
In the book, and I'm going to go off this subject because I'm having a lot of fun. You're a fun guy. You're a fascinating person to talk to because everything you say brings up all kinds of wild questions in my head. Let's take another break. So on the free side, and think of on the free side of how fun it would be if you weren't on the free side and if you were not going to be leaving us shortly. We'll be right back. It's a story about my wife, Anne. She passed on in 2015. An hour after she died, she began to come back. Now she's with us, and you can learn more about this and what it means to you and what it can mean to you so much more than you may think. Get the Afterlife Revolution. Get it today. You can read it on Kindle as a book. You can listen to me reading it as an audio book. It's a beautiful journey into a new way of understanding death and life. And yes, afterlife. There's a reason that Dr. Gary Schwartz, one of the great afterlife investigators in the world, says it's among the most convincing cases he has ever encountered. Afterlife Revolution. Don't miss it. Why are they here? What do they want with us? Why is it all so secret? All of these questions are explored in my new book, Them, in an entirely new way. What do Close Encounter reports tell us about what the visitors want with us? What is the military's experience? And can our memories be trusted? Can anything be trusted? Them answers all of these questions in a totally new way. It's available in hardcover, softcover, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook, read by me. Get them today, and you can get it from the unknowncountry.com store, signed by me. His new book, UFOs, A Scientist Explains What We Know and Don't Know. I would like to ask this question. You talk about natural language processing, using it to sift through UFO reports. And I found that part of the book very, very interesting and provocative. First, can you tell us what natural language processing is, and also how it would be applied to this data set?
Sure. So natural language processing is really using words that people use in everyday language to try to discern what their true thoughts and their true actions are. So here's a good example that the audience may be more familiar with. Let's say you go onto Facebook and you start using the word bomb, and you use the word plan, right? And a couple of other keywords. Well, an automated artificial intelligence system, right, that's monitoring Facebook would flag that, because they know, the system would know that anyone who uses the word bomb and plan, and let's say some other keywords such as a given date and things like that, that there's a higher likelihood that those individuals are planning something nefarious as compared to someone who's on Facebook and talks about Mother's Day and whatever, you know, other words they use. So the way you use that in the world of UFOs, for example, is you take your database of, let's say, 100,000 cases. And we know that the vast majority of those cases, 95% plus, are basically misidentifications, right? They're aircraft, they're the planet Jupiter, the star Sirius, or what have you. So if you want to analyze the data, you need to get the garbage material out of the database. So you can use natural language processing to do that. So let's say you look at your strongest cases and you say, what are the commonalities? So let's say you determine that in strong cases, the witnesses use descriptive words such as the object was, you know, 50 feet in size. It was in the constellation Orion. Words that indicate the witness is good at describing exact detail. And so you look at those type of words as compared to other reports where it's not as descriptive and it doesn't indicate that the witness is as knowledgeable, for example, of the skies as this other witness. So you use that to separate out reports. Now, will it make mistakes? Of course. You will wind up throwing out some good cases, right? But what you do, it's statistically effective, right? Because you have 100,000 cases. And so you try to overly be critical so that you can squeeze those 100,000 down to, say, 3,000. And so now you can go look for patterns. Is there a pattern? Can you discern a particular area of the country where this is more likely to happen? So that's basically what you do with natural language processing.
Okay, then give me some specific examples. I'm sorry. I forgot to put myself back in the picture. Here, boo, folks. Anyway, give me some specific examples of how this might work with some data that you're thinking about. If that's a good question, I'm not sure.
Sure. So let's say you create basically what's called a lexicon of words. So it's like a small dictionary of, say, 1,000 words. And you notice as you compare, you know, these strong cases against what you feel are weak cases, right? You select, say, 50 strong cases and 50 weak cases. You compare those and how the words are used. And then you weight those words, right? A positive value or a negative value. And then you take that and you apply it against the entire 100,000 cases. And so then you say, okay, I want, for example, I'm going to give a positive value when a witness uses the word azimuth or elevation or direction or words that you have found in the really good cases or more often used. While in the negative words, right? A negative word might be, for example, the witness uses the word alien, right? That could be negative because that means the witness is already drawing a conclusion as they're observing. And so you're looking for witnesses that are being just more factual and are not prejudiced in any direction. Yeah.
Well, before I want to ask you a question about a specific data set, which is the communion letters that are on file at Rice University. There's thousands of them, and they're being digitized. And I'm going to ask you in a minute exactly what you think we should do with that data once it's available in a digital format. But before I do that, free Dreamlanders, I got to say goodbye. It's time to say goodbye. We'll be back again next week, as always. And I can assure you the show will be as fascinating next week as it was this week. And maybe more so, who knows. Thanks very much for being with us on Dreamland.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.